the making of Roundtable and the years since the started and till now, and its vision in the future.
The idea of Dalit media and Dalit Bahujan, you know, articulation through mass media has been around for a long time. But surprisingly, there have been very few newspapers or periodicals or television channels. Even though there are some sections among the Dalits and Bahujans who are moneyed enough to support these ventures. So there always been a need, and it has been much more felt since the time of the Mandal One reservations issue. So we see in the local languages that there has been not growth of Dalit newspapers especially, and our Dalit periodicals, and a little different from the regular little magazines and other smaller media. So the idea has always been around, and we a group of people had been discussing this for some time, and there was Insight magazine, which was actually in a way has contributed to a small growth in Dalit Bahujan media on the internet. I don't believe that there is no Dalit or Bahujan media on the internet. There are Dalit sites, a lot of Dalit sites, a lot of Dalit voices, a lot of Dalit bloggers. There are also Bahujan site and some Bahujan bloggers, and there are also Adivasi and Pasmanda bloggers and other sites. They are all doing a very valuable job. So the idea of broad media portal wherein Dalit, Bahujan, Adivasi, Pasmanda voices could be heard has been around for some time among a group of small people like me and others. But it was basically the idea was put into action basically by our friend and associate Bhanu Pratap Singh of Delhi, and Anu, who of course works in the US, and they first put up the site, and they gave it the initial shape. We should all be thankful to Bhanu and Anu for
Anu Ramadas.
Yes, for giving this idea a concrete kind of shape, even if in the virtual world. They had discussed the idea with me, and I was always, strongly since the 80s. I felt that Indian media is woefully one-sided and very, very, negligent towards, to put it mildly, towards Dalit Bahujan views. So this is a natural progression, I suppose, that Roundtable India should happen. We should also thank technology for making it happen without much cost, because the financial aspects have been the most daunting aspects. Media is primarily capital intensive profession now in many ways. So it was Bhanu and Anu put it together, and I joined them, and it is taking shape by itself anyway. The different voices and the different issues and different let's say uh, ideas that are coming from the larger Dalit community and to an extent the Bahujan community and the Adivasi community and the Paspanda community. These are the factors which are shaping Round Table India more than any group of individuals. So that is the most important fact, that Round Table India is basically born from a community which is coming together. So it will also be as flexible and as agile, I hope, in the future also, in innovating and working itself to catch as much of the million mutinies happening in India as among the Dalit Bahujans as possible.
And this Round Table, why this name? Is this because of the Ambedkar's Round Table conference?
Exactly.
Could you explain it a little more for the audience?
This was Bhanu's idea. Bhanu had come up with the Round Table.
Why Round Table?
Obviously inspired by the events that had shaped Dr. Ambedkar's leadership and his articulation of Dalit views so very eloquently at what you could call an international conference anyway. So the Round Table, we thought, was a very appropriate name. But it might have certain problems on the internet because it also is confused with the other Round Table, which is...
Yeah, what is that and what is it?
So we want to stress, I think our content itself over a certain period, stress the importance of that Round Table conference.
Of Ambedkar's.
Ambedkar's. So this is basically centered around Ambedkar's vision of a society, of a democratic society, of people living together rather than living over each other, and how they associate with each other. So this basically is to bring to input into action certain ideals that Dr. Ambedkar had expressed. So that is the most vital aspect. Dr. Ambedkar's vision of his society itself is the most vital aspect. The democratic society he envisioned, where liberty, equality and fraternity are very important. So that is one of the most important aspects. And the goals he had set to educate, agitate and organize, I think that's what Roundtable also works on to an extent.
And how about this Dalit intellectuals contribution here? In the sense, I'm not talking about the organic intellectuals, which every day you find some kind of an intellectuality growing within the community.
Yes.
I'm talking about the so-called established intellectuals. What are the contributions and how was the reaction to this when you started?
The reaction as such couldn't have been very pronounced right from the beginning, because the idea of it, Dalit media portal, Dalit Bahujan media portal by itself has to sink in very slowly. And by and large, I think the response has been so very overwhelming.
That is from the larger public.
The larger public and also to the academia to an extent, because I am very, very grateful to certain old Dalit intellectuals like Dr. Palraj Dayanandan, Professor Shivshankar,
from Brajaranjan
Mani, yes, okay. Both from Tamil Nadu and Brajaranjan Mani, and also from younger academics like Dr. Ratnamala, Dr. Rajkumar, Dr. Shivshankar Das, researcher, and all kinds of many researchers, scholars from all across the country and also abroad. The general response has been very good, but the established network of intellectuals, Dalit intellectuals, the Bahujan intellectuals are who are much quoted or much publicized, or let's say much quoted. We have been trying to approach some of them, but I think it will take a little time for them to for us to access their views. But we generally feel that their voices are very much needed, as are the voices of the young people. You know, most of our readership is very young, very educated, and from very diverse backgrounds, and from across the regions and across continents. Let me emphasize this: none of this is spiel. Every one of this is fact. We have readership from across continents, across regions, across states, across languages, and also the contributors, also the writers, they also come from very diverse backgrounds, but they are all very young, very educated, very articulate, and the only gap that needs to be filled in a way is for the established group of intellectuals, as you pointed out, to also use Roundtable India, and I would like to make this a request to all of them to as their medium, because it is their medium.
And how about the general readership?
The general readership is also very good. Among the young, generally a curiosity, even though the media and the academia and general civil society tries to trash the issues of caste and downplay the voices of the marginalized. The general younger, before they are totally flooded by Hindutva voices or other voices which are plenty on the internet, they also respond quite positively to Roundtable, and Roundtable is as such allows for lots of different kinds of articulation, whether it's poetry and literary or creative writing, for research oriented writing, and also for popular writing or polemical writing, and also for documentation and for history. So there is a lot of things of interest in Roundtable for the general reader also, and it's building up every day. The people, the contributors, the community itself is building it every day. So we'll see how the future shapes up, and on our part, we intend to fortify certain sections of the Roundtable, very important sections wherein there a lot of material is needed, a lot of documentation is needed, like sections on rights and atrocities and policies. Especially we see very little articulation by even the most established Dalit intellectuals or Bahujan intellectuals on issues like the very important legislation being passed in the last 10 years, let's say, right from the right to information, to right to work, to right to food, to right to education. Civil society is grabbing a major part of this, essentially political decisions through the NAC, and that's what has given Anna Hazare to a lot of the lot of his adversity could be, you know, associated with the rise of civil society and the privileges and order on them through the NAC and other institutions by the ruling establishment, the ruling classes. They want to, you know, share a part of the policy decisions with the Savanna civil society rather than, you know, trust the somewhat Dalit Bahujan political society. So that is also happening. So, but we are not hearing a lot of, you know, important Dalit voices actually discussing these issues relating to right to information or right to work or right to food or right to well, lots of issues which concern social security, which is the most important issue for all Dalit Bahujans. The issues relating to primary education, right to education, and in our legislation without any, you know, endorsement of common schools or universal education gets passed. And a legislation which actually sanctifies the caste system in schooling. As Balraj Balchandra Mungekar said, there are around 25 to 35 different kinds of schools in India. There is a real caste system in Indian schooling system. There is a real caste system there, and none of Dalit Bahujan intellectuals are actively discussing this. So we can't always be the governed, or we can't always, you know, even politics of the governed shouldn't be played on such defensive ground, wherein somebody else makes a policy and you discuss it later or defend it or ask for provision within it. Even in the you know, the Anna Hazare team could have carried over the Lokpal legislation if even if at the late hour the Dalit Bahujan politicians hadn't objected in parliament, and the bill would have been passed. What could have been done, should have been done proactively, because corruption is the most important issue for the Dalit Bahujans more than anyone else. But we don't want to discuss corruption as separate from inequality, structural inequality. But all these issues should have been raised by us first, before this local issue came up. The issue of the state being, you know, indifferent, state territory being indifferent to Dalit Bahujan citizens and not being very transparent, should have been first discussed by the Dalit Bahujan foundations, their intellectual class themselves first. They are the most affected. They are the most affected by the lack of delivery or inefficient delivery of public services and of government supplied services. And they are not discussing it. They should have discussed it beforehand. Now, you know, individual RTI activist, if he is from a Dalit background or a Muslim background, he is pitted against the state. What does he get out of information he gets from a government agency? What can he do? Can he litigate on it? What is the redressal mechanism? Why does he have to go through all this long process? Why is the state by itself, the missionary by itself, made less caste concentrated? I mean, that's a new word. I can think of no other word, because the state machinery seems to be a concentrated site of caste prejudice, these issues should have been most important to Dalit intellectuals and Bahujan intellectuals more than anyone else.
So that has not been discussed anywhere, you mean?
And not been discussed in any media. Not just in media, but these issues, I want these issues also to be discussed, you know, and we shouldn't fall back and let someone else raise issues and then prepare ourselves to defend certain policies or attack certain policies, just like this cotton issue. There should have been a complete review of all these NCERT textbooks. The demand should have been made 6 years ago or 10 years ago when these textbooks were being framed. They can't keep loosely saying that, you know, Dalit activists are also participated, these people, Yogendra Yadav participated and all these people participated. There is one Sukhdev Tharat, there is one Gopal Guru, there is none, one Narendra Jadav, and they are supposed to be on 100 committees and they are supposed to oversee through all this, you know, minor details.
Do you mean to defend Gopal Guru and others?
Yeah, I mean, I want to say that, you know, the Dalit Bahujan participation is not there in the framing of policy, even in the framing of textbooks, in the framing of some left liberal bloggers have been, you know, mendaciously saying that this has been a textbook revolution. What revolution? Nobody, even know, Dalit intellectual seems to have heard of it. They didn't participate in it. Who are this? You know, handpicked 4 or 5 people are regularly mentioned, but they are how many committees are there supposed to be in? How many things are hassled of few intellectuals have to, you know, oversee?
But committees they have to reject, no? For example, if Gopal Guru is in 100 committees, he has to reject that. I don't want to be in many committees.
The paradox itself is such that they want to, you know, don't want to invite a participation proportionate with the Dalit population or the Dalit student population at least. There is no, you know, they merely indulge in nominal representation rather than, you know, real representation. Where is the real representation? What are these committees? And I have looked through all the executive committees, the governing committees, and all that NCERT on the NCERT site, just like on the National Advisory Council site. See, there is no representation. You know, you can't really call, you know, Narendra Yadav or Sukhdev Tharoat being on both NAC and on UGC and all. How many jobs can they handle? Is that the way to use such intellectual power? I mean, there are no Dalit academics, there are no Dalit writers, there are no Dalit researchers. At least for, writing part, can't they be on editorial committees, on review committees properly? I want to emphasize this need to proactively think on some of these issues, you know. At a civil society, there is a list of issues already in the internet which they are trying to bring legislation on, including this right to food and other issues, wherein Dalit Bahujan participation will come in after they have already drafted some legislation. And if you raise any objections, they will again similarly say that, you know, we don't understand what is the economics, just like they said, we don't understand what is aesthetics in the case of Ambedkar cartoon. I want any kind of articulation on policy issues and on general societal issues. We have to keep up with the spirit of Dr. Ambedkar. He would more thoroughly research on any subject, more thoroughly read, more thoroughly catch up on any subject. Even when he worked among small groups, even in his youngest days, he was